Kweyawiti. Bonjour à tous. Hello everyone. Sandokwa hiatsi, kwendoke hiatsi. Hyandia wishiwahi kuta, siwi hiwahi watsirute. Nous sommes la troupe Sandokwa qui veut dire aigle. We are Sandokwa troop, which means eagle. We are Wendat Nation, Huron, known as Huron in the past. Alors nous sommes de Wendake, les Huron-Wendat, et c'est un honneur pour nous de vous présenter nos chants et danses. It's an honor for us to be here, to be able to present you our dance and our songs. On huat son hiwa ndi hionhrat. Nous ne sommes qu'un seul esprit. May we all be one spirit.
Yo Yahweh ho, Yo Yahweh ho, Yo Yahweh ho, Yahweh ho, Haya, Yo Yahweh ho, Yo Yahweh ho, Yo Yahweh ho, Yahweh ho, Yahweh ho, Haya, Oh Haya, Way High High. Hi, hi, yo.
Merci. Thank you. Vous êtes ici pour une raison vraiment importante. Vous allez fouiller dans le corps de terre-mère. You're going to dig, or you are in the industry of you are very in contact with Mother Earth. This is what you do, or this is what your intentions are, to take the best of her, to have all the humans benefit from her, because she's a giver. Hein, la Mère Terre, c'est une donneuse, toujours. Et peut-être qu'on n'a jamais, vous avez jamais pensé au fait que pendant toute notre vie, during all of our life, she's giving us and we take from her. And that's a good thing. This is what it's meant for. It's how we do it that matters. C'est comment on le fait. Et ça nous permet d'être en contact avec le plus essentiel de ce que nous sommes aussi. This is essential for human beings to be in contact with Mother Earth. And I never realized, but one day an elder really focused on the fact that only when we die, we give her back. Seulement quand on meurt, on redonne à la Terre. Une fois dans notre vie, on lui redonne tout ce qu'on est. Everything we are that she's, well, we are her. Hein? On est vraiment la terre-mère, nous-mêmes. Tout ce qu'on est, ce qu'on mange, elle nous donne à manger, à boire, tout ce dont on a besoin. Les relations aussi. Quand on part, ce qui reste, c'est les relations. All our relations. So, thank you for doing it right, the way you are in contact with her. Merci de vous relier à elle d'une façon à ce que chacun puisse en bénéficier. Avant, pendant, après. So, la prochaine danse, ce sera la danse des couvertures pour honorer la terre-mère. This next dance is going to be the blanket dance. It used to be for different reasons, dance for a newborn baby, for a chief, or somebody new coming to the nation. Now we'll do it today for Mother Earth, for all of us, because she's all of us and we're all of her. The peacemaker. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I'm not going to do a dance. Thank you very much to Sandioko from the Huron tribe for their friendship dance to you. May I ask the Honorable Minister, Xieting Feng, Dr. Louis Lamas, Dr. John Hudson, Dr. Bradley, to come up to the stage. Honorable Mine Minister, Monsieur Luc Blanchet, ISRM President, Secretary General, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of my co-chairs, Dr. Jamie Archibald and Dr. John Hadjigeorgio, the President of CARMA, Dr. Jim Hazard, and Dr. Herbert Einstein from MIT, the chair of the Shale Conference, I welcome you to ISRM 2015 Congress. And I also welcome you to our beautiful city of Montreal and province of Quebec. Your presence has already guaranteed the success of this Congress. This Congress has been in production for the last 4 years. And my team has put together an excellent technical sessions with very high quality articles. We received 970 abstracts, and after double review, we chose 450 of them, which will be presented in these next 3 days. And we had seven very high quality keynote speaker from around the world for you. We had several workshops on Saturday and Sunday which took place, and over 150 people attended them. Apart from the high quality 64 technical session, that is 8 parallel session, we have fantastic banquet with good food, music, and a taste of our Quebec culture. By the way, there's only 20 tickets left. For those who still want to come, please go and get them downstairs before I'll finish. I would like to take this opportunity to thank our sponsors, CARMA, CIM, Rock Engineering Society of CIM, and the Underground Mining Society of CIM. I would like to draw your attention to the Shale Conference organized by Dr. And Professor Herbert Einstein of MIT. I'm very grateful to him because he single-handedly brought top-notch people to make presentation in this conference. I would like to thank all the session chairs for their contribution. And I know there were some changes had to be made because over 40 people could not make the Congress because of the visas in Canadian Embassy. I'll blame our Prime Minister Harper on that. There is also an exhibition with over 500 booths downstairs. Whenever you get time, please go and have a look at that as well. I thank you again for your presence here and hope that you have a good Congress and take time after the Congress and visit our beautiful province. I now would like to take this opportunity to introduce our honorable guest, Honorable Mine Minister Luc Blanchet, Minister of Mines and Northern Affairs. Mr. Luc Blanchet holds a degree in economics and project management from the Université de Québec and Université Québec de Témiscamingue. In the course of his career as an economist, he has held position of increasing responsibility of organization in Abitibi region of Quebec, and he has also served as an economics consultant to Hydro-Quebec and as a regional economist with the Government of Canada. He taught at UCAT, the University of Quebec, for more than 25 years, and he has played an active role on the broad number of education, health, and social service agencies. On April 7, 2014, Mr. Blanchet was elected as MNA of Rouyn-Noranda Témiscamingue and was appointed Minister of Mine responsible for Abitibi Témiscamingue region and Minister of Northern Quebec region. Mr. Minister. Thank you.
Alors, bonjour tout le monde. Salutations à M. Assani, M. Fang, M. Lamas, Bradley, and Hudson. Di hao in Chinese, bom dia in the Portuguese, buenos dias in Italian, welcome, and wachia for the Cree community. J'ai une confidence à vous faire. Tout le monde sait que la ville de Salzbourg, en Autriche, est reconnue pour sa richesse culturelle. Après tout, c'est la cité qui a vu Mozart et Schubert, mais aussi les acteurs Arnold Schwarzenegger et Romy Schneider, bien sûr, et ceux qui ont les petits problèmes pour Sigmund Freud. Je dois cependant vous avouer que ce fut une surprise pour moi de découvrir que Salzbourg, le siège social de l'IRS, avait aussi un riche passé minier. En effet, son nom l'indique, c'est le sel qui a contribué à la richesse de Salzbourg. L'ISRM, compte tenu de l'importance pour Salzbourg de ce qu'on appelait à l'époque l'or blanc, il n'est donc pas surprenant de constater que c'est aussi le berceau de l'International Society for Rock Mechanics, ISRM, un organisme fondé en 1962 par le professeur Léopold Müller. À titre de ministre québécois délégué aux mines, je suis très heureux que l'ISRM ait choisi le Québec pour y tenir son congrès annuel 2015. C'est un honneur de recevoir à Montréal, en marge du congrès de l'Institut canadien des mines, de la métallurgie et du pétrole, l'ICM, les plus grands spécialistes mondiaux de la mécanique des roches. Je suis fier de dire que certains des plus grands spécialistes au monde dans le domaine de la mécanique des roches sont au Québec. Plusieurs chercheurs reconnus travaillent dans ce champ d'expertise au sein de nos plus prestigieux établissements, à savoir l'Université McGill, dont est issu notre facilitateur, l'Université Laval et Polytechnique. Le fait que nous soyons ouverts sur le monde y est pour beaucoup. L'expertise québécoise, nous l'avons évidemment acquise sur le terrain en relevant les défis importants que représente l'exploitation des gisements filoniens dans le bouclier canadien. Comme je viens d'une région minière, sur 100 km de la faille de Cadillac, il y a tout de même eu près de 130 mines en Abitibi-Témiscamingue sur une période de 100 ans. J'aimerais d'ailleurs vous rappeler que le Québec abrite la mine souterraine La Ronde, une des mines les plus profondes que j'ai eu le plaisir de visiter, à 3,3 km de profondeur de la surface. C'est donc creuser de belles profondeurs exige des conditions particulières pour assurer la sécurité des personnes tout en optimisant la productivité. Cette expertise, nous l'avons aussi acquise en s'ouvrant sur le monde, en restant à l'affût des dernières découvertes, en échangeant des connaissances avec d'autres collègues et en participant à des activités scientifiques à l'international. Le réseautage est tout de même quelque chose d'avenir et c'est ce avec quoi on aura composé pour de bien longues années encore. Le congrès 2015 de l'ISRM est justement l'occasion idéale pour nos experts d'échanger avec les sommités mondiales et de continuer à en apprendre sur ce domaine d'expertise capitale pour le secteur minier. Car il faut bien le dire, la mécanique des roches est une science cruciale pour le secteur minier. Premier enjeu, la sécurité, bien sûr. Le premier enjeu auquel elle permet de répondre est la sécurité des travailleurs et des travailleuses dans les mines. Pour une meilleure compréhension du terrain, nous parvenons à contrôler celle-ci et à mieux gérer les incertitudes. Le Québec a d'ailleurs un bilan très positif en matière de sécurité minière. Le deuxième enjeu est celui de l'atteinte de meilleurs taux de productivité possible pour la récupération optimale du minerai, Pour cela, il faut bien sûr pouvoir prédire le comportement du terrain. C'est notamment par l'utilisation des modèles informatiques complexes que nous parvenons à prédire les mouvements géologiques. Toutefois, les ressources humaines qui sont assez spécialisées pour travailler avec de tels outils sont des denrées rares. Et ce qui m'amène à un double enjeu de l'expertise universitaire, c'est-à-dire la recherche et le développement de la connaissance. J'entends par là l'enjeu de l'innovation dans les modèles prédictifs et l'enjeu de la formation d'ingénieurs spécialisés dans ce domaine. En conclusion, c'est en faisant les prédictions les plus précises possibles que nous arriverons à réduire les risques d'accidents, car après tout, c'est le capital humain dont il est question ici. Et j'aimerais aussi vous inviter à Québec Mines, qui se tiendra du 23 au 26 novembre prochain, une activité qui regroupe plusieurs intervenants de la recherche, du gouvernement et bien sûr de l'entreprise privée, des fournisseurs équipementiers et entreprises minières et d'exploration. Cette occasion, vous pourrez en apprendre plus sur les sujets chauds en matière de développement minier au Québec. Et là-dessus, je vous souhaite un bon congrès. Et merci beaucoup, Miigwech, pour les Autochtones et bien sûr pour le siège social, bien, Dankeshe. Merci.
Merci, Monsieur Minister. May I ask our ISRM President, Xueting Feng, to come and say a few words, please?
Good morning, distinguished Minister, guests, Chairman, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to this 13th International Congress of the International Society for Rock Mechanics. It is a delight for the ISRM to be able to hold this Congress in Canada, to say that so many of you have been able to attend. On behalf of the ISRM and the organizers, I welcome you all. As many of you will know, our ISRM congresses are held every 4 years. They started in Portugal in 1966, which was 4 years after the formation of the ISRM in 1962. After that, they were located in Yugoslavia, the United States, Switzerland, Australia, Canada, Germany, Japan, France, South America, Portugal again, and China. This time is come back to Canada again. Even before we began the official opening today, there has been considerable Congress-related activities, including the ISRM Board Council and Commission meetings, together with our short course and workshops on Saturday and Sunday. The current ISRM board has been very active over the last 4 years, 2011 to 2015, and has developed at least 30 modernization initiatives, including creation of online lectures, glossary book series, education fund, students' night, rockball game, 5 volumes of rock and mechanics and engineering, introducing the main progress of rock mechanics and engineering within 20 years. Technique Oversight Committee, Outstanding Technique Commission Award, Best Performing National Group Award. We expanded our digital library very much, where our members can download up to 100 papers per year from previous ISRM sponsored symposia. The Roger Medal has gotten higher recognition. Applicants for the Roger Medal 2016 reached 25, so which is the double as before. The society is now more dynamic and larger. 16 sponsored sponsors has been held, and 17 sponsored sponsors has been approved. The number of national groups increased to 59 from 48, which increased by 23%. Individual and cooperative members also increased by 20%, respectively. Over the next 3 days, we have an excellent series of plenary, regular, and poster sessions. Please don't forget that there is also a concrete exhibition with exhibitors waiting to show you the products and answer your questions. All our thanks to go to Professor Ferry Hassani, Chairman of the Organizing Committee, for arranging both an excellent show of papers and an enjoyable congress here in Montreal, Canada. Special thanks to also given to Canadian Institute of Mining, Metallurgy and Petroleum, Canadian Rock Mechanics Association for your kind support to this congress. Additionally, our appreciation extended to the organizing committee members and the participants for ensuring such a successful gathering. I hope that you will all enjoy your visit to Canada, enjoy this Congress, take a good idea of rock mechanics, and appreciate all that Montreal and Canada have to offer. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Feng. I would like now to ask the Secretary General, Dr. Luis Lamas, to come to.
So good morning, everybody. I'm going to make a presentation on the current status of the SRM. This is a presentation that we usually do at our yearly meetings so that the participants in our conferences know what the SRM is. I believe that most of you probably don't know very well what it is, so the idea is to let you know better what we do. We are a non-profit scientific association. We were founded in 1962, so over 50 years ago, in Salzburg by Professor Leopold Müller. And we have a council that represents national groups. We are organized in national groups that meet yearly at the council. There's a board elected by the national groups. And our field of activities is very broad and includes rock mechanics and rock engineering, applied to civil mining and petroleum engineer works. That's how it's defined in our statutes. This is just a photograph of the impressive setting that we had yesterday for the council meeting that took place in the next room. The society is run by a board. This is the current board. You'll find all of these people around here. And we have now been increasing our membership in the past 12 years, and we are nearly reaching 8,000 members. Hopefully by next year or so, we'll have this figure. You'll see those colors represent the continents. Yellow is Europe, and you see how important Asia has been becoming in the past 10 or 15 years. One of the things we do is we sponsored conferences. Our main conferences are our international congresses. In 2015, we are here in Montreal for the 13th Congress, and we'll have the in 4 years the 14th Congress in Foz do Iguaçu in Brazil. We have every year international symposium. Next year, in a very beautiful place in Turkey, in Cappadocia. And in 2 years' time, also in a very beautiful place in Cape Town in South Africa. We also have regional symposia for the several regions of the society in Europe, South America, Asia, and so on. And besides that, we promote the organization of smaller size conferences, and this is just a list of conferences that we have been sponsoring this year and next year. One of the main and the most important aspects of our work is the technical commissions. We have 18 very active technical commissions on the topics you have there. So if you are interested in collaborating in any of those topics, you shall approach either your regional vice president or the secretariat or the commission president and enter in contact with them so that you can cooperate in this kind of work. We also give awards. Our most important award is the Mueller Award. It's awarded every 4 years in recognition of distinguished contributions to the profession of rock engineering and rock mechanics. And you'll hear, we will have the next Mueller lecture in a few minutes given by Professor Hudson. We also have an important award for PhD thesis. This is the Roscher Medal to honor the memory of Professor Manuel Roscher, who organized the first Congress of the Society. The Council selected yesterday the recipient of the 2016 Roscher Medal, Xia Wang Boom from Malaysia, and also chose two runner-up certificates, Sylvia Duca from Italy and Shen Bingzhang from China. For the next award, so if you are finishing your PhD or if you have finished it recently and you think you have a very good PhD thesis, you can apply for this award, and submissions for the 2007 medal are open until the 31st of December 2015. Communication is very important in the ISRM. We have a news journal that you can get in paper in our booth, but that is distributed to everybody electronically. But some people still like to have the real paper version, so that's the place where you have it, is here. It has news of the society and technical articles. It's distributed by email to all our members and all that register on our website to get it. And of course, the digital version is available there. You can read it on the website. For communication, we also have quarterly newsletters that are distributed by email to all our members and also to all those that subscribe to receive it. And contributions from any of you are welcome, with short news or short articles of general interest in rock mechanics. So if you have anything of interest that you think you'd like to share with the rock mechanics community, send it to me and we'll try to include it in this quarterly newsletters. Our website has been upgraded recently. You can see here the growth in the daily in the downloads and in the amount of downloads in green and number of visitors for the past 10 years, so it has been growing quite a lot, and that's how the website looks. I hope that most of you have been there. We started last year also a page in LinkedIn to help disseminate news to a broad audience of rock mechanics professionals, and also in Twitter, look for at InSoc Rock Mech and add us to your Twitter feed, and don't miss any news on the society. We have publications. Suggested Methods are nowadays our most important publications. It's a continuous work done by a very good commission of the SRM, the Commission on Testing Methods. The Blue Book was published in 2007 with all the suggested methods published until that time. And last year we published what we call the Orange Book, with all the suggested methods published, prepared between 2007 and 2014. This latter one is published by Springer at a very reduced price for ISRM members. ISRM members get a very, very substantial discount. Still regarding publications, we have a digital library in cooperation with the Society of Petroleum Engineers at this address here, www.onepetro.org. Currently, we have nearly 7,000 papers and nearly 50,000 pages from 35 of our sponsored events since the first Congress in 1966. And all ASR members are allowed to have 100 downloads per year, which I think is enough for most of us. And corporate members are allowed to download 250 papers. We have also a series of online lectures. Every 3 months, we have an online lecture by a distinguished professional. The last one we had was by Professor Dick Stacey in March. And the next one will be by Professor Ove Stefansson in early July. And the title will be announced very soon to all of you. We started an education fund in order to enhance education in rock mechanics and rock engineering, and in order to plan, fund, coordinate, and conduct educational activities for the benefit of education of the ISRM community. We hope that in the near future, this education fund will be of great help to our young members. Recent developments. The first book of the ISRM book series is going to be launched today. And for those of you who would like to have the book, it will be launched. It will be available outside this door here. And at 3 p.m., the authors, John Hudson and Xiaoting Feng, will be there and will be able to sign copies of the book for you. We have a multilingual rock mechanics glossary with 1,000 words that was launched in March 2015. We have now 11 languages there, but more will be added very soon. Still, the board recently started two awards, the Outstanding Commission Award, and the board 2 days ago decided to give it to two of our commission, Testing Methods and Crustal Stress and Earthquakes, and the Best Performing National Group Award given to China and Singapore. And this book, Rock Mechanics and Engineering, a file volume book coordinated by John Hudson and Xiaoting Feng, is planned to be published soon. For information on the SRM, so if you wish to have more information, please visit our website, contact your national group, contact the ISRM Vice President of your region or the Secretary General at this address that we have here. Thank you very much.
May I ask Professor Feng to come and make an introduction to the Mueller Prize winner, Dr. John Hudson.
It is my great honor to introduce Mueller Award and the winner, Professor John Hudson. The Mueller Award honors the memory of the Professor Leopold Mueller, the founder and the fourth president of the ISRM from 1962 to 1966. Professor Mueller aggregated to Salzburg Group scientists from all over the world interested in the new broad branch of science, so rock mechanics, and to form our society. His purpose was to bring together and to give unity to the scattered knowledge obtained by the group, so working as a solidate problem posed by rock masses. So this award is given every 4 years at the Congress since 1991. It's given in recognition of distinguished contribution to the profession of rock mechanics and rock engineering. The recipient delivered the Mueller Lecture, and the award consisted of a work of art typical of the culture of the country and hosting the Congress, accompanied by a silver medallion with the portrait of Leopold Mueller and the engraved name of the recipient and the date and the title of the award. The previous recipient, the Professor Harry Avery Hawk from Canada, and Cook, Professor Cook from United States, Professor Einstein from United States, and Professor Fairhurst from United States, and Professor Brown from Australia, and Dr. Nicholas Barton from UK. So Mueller Award 2015 is awarded to Professor John Harrison from UK. Professor John Harrison is the career in rocket mechanics that started in World College Scotland in 1962. So where he obtained the phase working certificate for longwall coal mining. He obtained his bachelor degree in mining engineering from Herbert and Ward University, Scotland, UK in 1965. And his PhD in rocket mechanics from the University of Minnesota, USA in 1971. His Doctor of Science was awarded in 1982 for his contribution to rocket mechanics. And also from this university, he is now the Emeritus Professor at Imperial College London, UK, and also a Fellow of the UK Royal Academy of Engineering, a Fellow of the International Society for Rocket Mechanics, and also a Fellow of American Rocket Mechanics Association. So after his PhD in 1971, he worked in the Turner's Division of the Transport and Road Research Laboratory, UK, and then in the Strategic Research Operation Division of the Department of Environment, UK. And he took a sabbatical in 1979 to 1980 as a visiting professor in the Department of Mining and Metallurgy at the University of Wisconsin, United States. Following his sabbatical, he worked in Geotechnical Division Building Research Station, UK. In 1983, he was appointed as a reader in the Department of Mineral Resources Engineering and Imperial College, London, UK, and became professor in 1989. And during this time, he was director of the Engineering Rock Mechanics Master Course, and he has also held many visiting academic positions over the years. So since 1985, through his independent consulting, rock engineering consulting, and he has been involved with over 150 rock engineering projects in many countries, including export witness work and radioactive waste-related research. In particular, he has chaired the International Cooperative Project, the COVALAX, from 2007 to 2015. So, and also he gave the short course in many countries, for example, Australia, Austria, Brazil, Chile, China, Colombia, Finland, Hong Kong, India, Peru, Singapore, UK, and the United States. Professor John Harrison has written 12 books and 94 journal papers and 98 conference papers. He was editor of the International Journal of Rocket Mechanics and Mining Sciences for 24 years. And also he's editor-in-chief of the Comprehensive Rock Engineering with Professor Brown, Fairhurst, and Hawk. That's a 5-volume, 4,400 pages. So many contributions to our society, including the president 2007 to 2011, and representative for many years, and the president of the commission in testing methods, also the chairman of several ISM symposia, including the fourth Europe, and the president of the commission on design methodology from 2007, and also several ISM books and the editor of news journal from 2007 to this year. So today, Professor John Hudson will give a Mueller lecture on engineering in fracture rock masses. So please, Luis.
Well, thank you very much for that introduction. I feel I should give the lecture first before getting the medal, but So distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, it's a delight to be here in this position, and I'm very grateful to the ISRM for having bestowed this award upon me. I chose this title, Engineering and Fractured Rock Masses, because this is the theme of the origin of the ISRM, and also the six Mueller lecturers who have preceded me. So I want to start by just showing one slide of some rock mechanics from a long time ago, before the ISRM was formed, and then to just show one or two slides about the formation of the ISRM, and then give some quotations from previous ISRM lectures, and then talk about my philosophy of how to deal with fractured rock masses and where I think we're going. So this is the first slide, and of course we shouldn't think that rock mechanics began with the ISRM. At the top, at the top here, in 1942, there was a book written, The Dynamics of Faulting, and this was by E.M. Anderson, and maybe many of you have heard of the Anderson fault classification. And so there was an understanding there about the stresses in the Earth's crust and the fact that it could cause discontinuities or fracturing. And so this fault classification is a function of the magnitudes of the principal stresses, and you get the normal thrust and strike slip depending on which directions you have the maximum principal stress. So I think this was very advanced in 1942, and E.M. Anderson was a member of the British Geological Survey at that time. Now the second one I show at the bottom here is an International Strata Control Congress, of which I had the proceedings, and you can see in those two photographs that there's a study of what happens when you compress a sample of rock and how the boundary conditions are very important. And if you have a high platen friction, you get one type of failure, and with a low platen friction, you get another type of failure. And so over the years, and certainly during my career, there's been a lot of people studying this. But this is an early demonstration of the fact that it was going on in 1958, and probably it was going on before that. So just briefly about the formation of the ISRM by Leopold Müller in 1962, we have some information here that when Professor Müller was interviewed for a radio station and the reporter asked, "Do we know the strength of rock?" Professor Müller replied, "For rock specimens tested in the laboratory, yes. For a rock mass, no. This is what we need to determine. This is why we need an international society for rock mechanics." And Ted Brown has reminded me that we may not know precisely what he said, but his exact words may be lost in the mist of time. But this is the essence of what he said, that rock specimens tested in the laboratory, like in the previous slide, is not what the rock mass is all about. And so we're dealing with a completely different animal when we have an in-situ rock mass. And as most of you will know, we had the 50th anniversary of the ISRM in 2012 at the Beijing Congress. And Louis Lamas, our Secretary General, who's just given a talk, and myself put this book together about the history of the ISRM. And so if you are interested in the formation of the ISRM and Professor Müller, there are a lot of information and copied documents in there. So when I knew that I was going to give the Müller lecture, I went back and looked at all the previous six Müller lectures. And there's quite a running theme going on. So the first one by Everett Hooke, "When is a design in rock engineering acceptable? There are no simple universal rules for design acceptability, nor standard factors of safety. And failure is frequently controlled by the presence of discontinuities such as faults, shear zones, bedding planes, and joints." In 1995, Noel Cook, with the title "Why Rock Mechanics," he quotes Professor Müller, and he says, "Discontinuity and anisotropy are the most characteristic properties of rock materials, and the properties of the jointed media depend much more on the linkage between discontinuous systems than on the substance of the rock." And Herbert Einstein, "Puzzles in Rock," which I feel a particular, I have not actually worked with Professor Einstein, but I feel a particular empathy with his philosophy and with his papers, where he says, "The puzzles are in the interactions. What one likes to do is to formally capture the lack of knowledge, or said otherwise, formally express the uncertainty and then make decisions under uncertainty." And I'm going to show a picture of the interactions, because I think that's particularly important, and the huge difference between solid rock and fractured rock. Then in 2003, Charles Fairhurst, "Rock Mechanics and Radioactive Waste Isolation, One Small Step for Geology, One Giant Leap for Rock Mechanics." And he also quotes Leopold Müller. Charles Fairhurst was my PhD advisor. In fact, I can't believe that it was 50 years since I took a plane from the UK to Minnesota to start on my PhD. And Charles was one of the first members of the ISRM, and he discussed numerical modeling of rock mechanics in his lecture. And I want to talk a bit about that later on. And then Ted Brown, "Rock Mechanics, the Basic Mining Science, Challenges in Underground Mass Mining." So he discussed underground caving mines. And of course, there you have a fractured rock and you're utilizing the potential energy and creating new fractures. And so it's quite a complicated operation. And with his usual sense of humor, Brown's first law of caving geomechanics: there are no easy answers. And then the most recent Müller lecture, Nick Barton, "From Empiricism Through Theory to Problem Solving in Rock Engineering." And discontinuous behavior provides rich experiences for those who value reality, even when reality has to be simplified by some empiricism. And I like that sentence very much. So you can see that there's a running theme through these Mueller lectures, and I want to continue with that theme. Now, when we're dealing with a fractured rock mass as opposed to a piece of rock in the laboratory, it's complicated. And we like the solid rock if it's continuous, homogeneous, maybe isotropic. And it may be elastic, and of course elastic means that when you load it up and you put energy into it, you can recover all that energy back out again. But this fractured rock mass, this particular example, this is none of those things. It's not continuous, it's not homogeneous, it's not isotropic, and it's not elastic. So we need a whole different philosophy of dealing with it. And if you look at those fractures and you wanted to model them, how do you do that? You can study the general principles of fracturing in rocks and the influence on displacements and the stresses and displacements by simulating fractures in the laboratory, random fractures and so on. But we would like to actually model a real rock mass. And so how do you measure those fractures, and how do you characterize them, and how do you put them into a numerical program? Which of these fractures came first? So if you were simulating, rather than modeling in general, you were specifically simulating this rock mass, how would you get this geometry into the computer? So that's when we bring in the structural geologist. And the structural geologist will explain that these fractures formed in different sequences. And so you have the first ones here, so the through-going fractures occurred first, and then you can see that the second one is terminating here, so this followed, and then the third one coming down here, terminating here, and then the fourth one terminating there. And so if we're going to make a computer model of this, we definitely need to have the geometry and these terminations built into it. And then, of course, we're only looking at it in 2D here, so we have to look in 3D, so how do we get the information to put into the program? So these fracture characteristics are not easy to measure and model. And I like to think of this picture when dealing with a specific rock mass, that we have a general piece of rock, there are forces acting on it, we have fractures going through, we have the intact rock, we have water flow going through, and we have an excavation here. And I show this small tunnel here because it delightfully illustrates the sort of generic problem. And in terms of the stresses, you can see that there's no stress, no normal or shear stress on this face here. We'll have a vertical component of stress there. Now, in terms of the fractures, you can see the bedding planes here and the cross fractures. In terms of the water flow, you can see the vegetation here. And so the water is flowing along the strata and supporting the vegetation. So then the engineer comes along in this little small tunnel and makes a hole in the ground. And you can see how at the portal, it's broken away very nicely along these fractures. So I like to think of a generic, this is a generic problem, of which that is one nice illustration of the case. But as I say, it's complicated. This was a case in a open cast coal mining, and you can see the coal seam along the bottom here. And of course, coal has a low angle of low friction. And due to glaciation, there was this lystric faulting developed, and you can see it coming down here and asymptoting to the coal seam there because of the low friction. So in the slide I showed with the fractures in the limestone, they were fairly linear, but now we've got curved fractures, which is an even worse problem. And so my structural geology colleague at Imperial College, Professor John Cosgrove, many of you may know him, we started thinking about how we could think about the fractures that occurred. And so here's a diagram we produced, where on the left, there is an undeformed intact rock at the top. And then we go through a spectrum of the formation of fractures, going through the tensile fracture, the next one, shear fractures, brittle shear zone, ductile shear zone, through to a pervasive ductile fabric. So this is very much a simplification, but showing that tensile fractures here, shear fractures, and then more complicated types of fractures to do with the formation of the rock. So through that spectrum, you get a decreasing localization of deformation. In other words, these are localized fractures, and then they are all coming together here. Increasing pervasiveness of deformation, increasing pressure and temperature, decreasing strain rates, because these are happening quickly and that taking much longer. And we're going from continuity to discontinuity to back to continuity again. So in terms of the rock mechanics characterization, of course we have no problem with the what we can think of as intact rock. If it's got a pervasive ductile fabric like that, then maybe it's transversely isotropic. And in between, we have a whole spectrum of difficulty if we're trying to model this. So the rock mechanics characterization is difficult in this region here. And there are some core boxes from the Posiva site investigation in Finland. Posiva is the organization that is responsible for the disposal of radioactive waste in Finland, and there's been a long 30-year period of building up to having a repository there with 50 kilometers or so of boreholes, and they have just obtained the conditional permission to have a radioactive waste repository there. And so there are lots and lots of borehole cores, core boxes, but one has to analyze what the borehole has gone through in the rock mass through these essentially one-dimensional samples. And there are fairly sort of sharp fractures, as you can see here, but there are also brittle deformation zones, large faults in the rock there. So these are some of the problems of the complexity of the geology and the difficulty that we have of sampling it. And many of you will be familiar with this ISRM fracture properties recommendation from some years ago by Nick Barton. And again, we have this complexity. Some of these properties are easy to measure. And so if we go along a borehole and we intersect fractures, we can look at the distance between the fractures, we can get the fracture frequency, the RQD, and so on. But if we want to know the persistence, which was evident in two dimensions on that earlier limestone slab, there's no way we can get this information here. And yet, if we want to model a rock mass like that, we actually need that information. And as I'm going to be talking about the interactions, we need to know most of these properties if we're going to validly model a rock mass. Now, of course, it depends why you need the information and how accurately you need to model it. But just in principle, if you wanted to model this and take all these properties into account, it's definitely not easy. And I just show some pictures now to think about rock masses and whether we can characterize them. You see the basaltic columns there, and we've got some nice scale because there's a rock climber climbing up there. It's not something I would do in a site investigation. And on the right-hand side, that's the cover of the book that was shown, Limestone and Mudstone Strata. So we might think with those two rock masses that maybe we can get a handle on this fracturing. But there are subtleties. It's still not easy, even with that the limestone here and getting the actual information into the numerical model. And just to show some illustrations of rock masses to think about how we can get this information that we need. On the left is a granite quarry in Poland. And you can see the exfoliation fractures here where the stress has been released and the fractures have formed. But there are also other fractures in there. But still, we might feel, well, we can begin to get a handle on that. But then in the right-hand diagram, this is a picture of a rock mass in Finland. And you can see through-going fracture here. But there are other features around here. And so we'd have to look at that much more carefully. This is a picture of some, on the left, a picture of a sandstone rock mass in China. And again, that looks fairly clean, and perhaps we think that we could get to model that, assuming in other places there were no other types of fractures. But look at the chalk strata on the right-hand side. This is the lower chalk that the Channel Tunnel goes through from England to France, or France to England. And look how complicated that is. You have these vertical fractures, and you have conjugate fractures. And the more you look at that, the more fractures you can see. So I'm just showing a spectrum of these to show that there's no one sort of clear method of dealing with this fractured rock. Now, people have said, well, we can use an elasticity approach for the intact rock, so let's use the elasticity approach for the fractured rock. And so I expect most people here have gone through learning about elasticity. And at the bottom, for a perfectly isotropic rock, which means it has the same properties in all directions, we can have the two elastic constants, Young's modulus and Poisson's ratio. Now, above that, which perhaps looks like one of the pictures we showed, maybe we can think of this as a transversely isotropic rock, and then we need five elastic constants. Two Young's moduli, two Poisson's ratio, and one shear modulus. Or if it gets more complicated, we have fractures going in all the directions, and it looks fairly geometrically okay, maybe we can, the orthotropic, we can use nine elastic constants. Now, if you look at the theory, at the top, for a generally anisotropic rock, you need 21 elastic constants. And in my career, I've never met anybody who's measured all 21 elastic constants in an intact piece of rock. And it may be tempting to apply this elasticity theory to fractured rocks and try to squeeze in some fracture system into this scheme. But it's completely wrong to do that because the rock is not elastic. You push on the rock and you put energy into it and you remove the stress and you don't get the energy out, especially the jointing. And there can be many different fillings in the joints. And so I don't believe that this is the way to go. And the same here, it might look that this is a very sort of cleanly fractured rock mass. And you can see the fractures nicely in the three different orthogonal directions. But it's still not correct because the fractures are not elastic, and I think it can be quite misleading to apply that. And another thing is that we are familiar in engineering with three perpendicular axes, X, Y, and Z. But in the terms of the number of fractures that you intersect, so you think of a line through the rock mass. And if you had a limestone like this, where there are two sets of fractures here, one set there and another set there, you could ask the question, well, in what direction do I have the minimal frequency? Well, that will be perpendicular to the sets that are furthest, where the fractures are furthest apart. But the direction of maximum frequency is not perpendicular. And the reason for that is because to get the maximum frequency, you can go off here, sort of not exactly perpendicular, but you can also pick up the other one here. And it's all to do with the resolution of the cos of the angle. And so when you look at this for a particular rock mass, and you look at what is the fracture frequency in any direction through the rock mass, you find that the directions of maximum and minimum are not perpendicular. And so this is yet another reason why we can't use some kind of standard theory. This is a diagram produced by my colleague John Harrison when we were working together in Imperial College. And this is a stereographic projection showing for a particular four sets with the directions there, what directions you get the maximum frequency and what directions you get the minimum. So the minimum is where you have two sets coming together and you're going along the line of intersection. And the maximum depends on the contributions from the different sets. So it's quite easy to play around with this. The only complication is that when you resolve with a cos, it has to be the positive value of the cos. And it's very instructive to look at this for different types of fracture sets. Now, I've always been interested in the interactions, and here's a diagram, I hope this is readable, of six interactions. So let's start off with these three things, the rock structure, the stress, and the water flow. And let's look at the binary interactions in each case. So at the top left, what is the influence of the rock structure on the stress? Well, if the fracture's open, there's a huge difference because the stress has to be diverted, if you like, so that it's the principal stress is parallel to the fracture. And if the fracture's open, there can be no stress perpendicular to the fracture. Then if we look at what is the influence of the rock structure on the water flow up here, then in many rocks, most of the water goes through the fractures. And so it's the water flowing through is dominated by the fractures. If we look here, what is the influence of stress on the rock structure? Well, that's how the, if you like, how the fractures got there in the first place. But when we have the engineering and we change the stresses, there can be movements there, and we can even trigger earthquakes with our engineering. If we look at the bottom, what is the influence of the water flow on the rock structure? Well, if you keep water flowing through a fracture for a long time, it can alter the properties of the fracture. Then what is the influence of the water flow on the stress? Well, we have the concept of the water from the water pressure, we have the concept of the effective stress. And then what is the influence of the stress on the water flow? Well, that's where the maximum principal stress here, you close up the fractures, and there the fractures can be more open. So all these things are interrelated. And that's why, as I said earlier, I particularly like Herbert Einstein's approach, where he says it's all in the interactions. And I agree with that completely when we're dealing with fractured rocks. So these things are going on. And if we want to model, depending on what our objective is in the modeling, we have to take these things into account. So do we have models, computer models, which are either modeling in general or simulating a specific rock mass? Can we actually get the data to put into the numerical models that is sufficient to model this situation? Now, of course, it depends on what your objective is for the modeling. But I pose that as a question because that, I think, is the direction we're going in. And are we going to go in a direction where we get more and more complicated and there's more and more information in the models? Or can we sort of not do it in that way, but have some kind of neural network approach to this and somehow be able to calibrate it? So I think we've got a great future in rock mechanics in the development of models for modeling fractured rock masses. And here's a three-deck diagram, again from the Posiva group in Finland, and Johnny Valley, who did this simulation. So what you're looking at here is a horizontal layer in the ground. There are brittle fracture zones going through the system here. There's a facility here, which is a spiral ramp going down to the proposed repository area. And what has been put into this model is a northwest, southeast overriding stress, which is due to the Mid-Atlantic ridge, which is thought to be pushing with 25 megapascals. And then we look at this and we say, okay, well, what's the magnitude of the maximum principal stress in these different places? And you can see there's a lot of red there and there's a lot of green there. And so we could, luckily that's in a relatively low area, but it would be so nice to have a picture like this before we put our facility in the ground so that we, if it was important to reduce the stresses, we could put it in a location where the stresses were less than in another place. But this, if I can go back, yeah, this is only one of the things I showed you. This is the influence of rock structure on the stresses. So how are the stresses affected by the fracture? And so there it is. Now this may not be right exactly, but it certainly is a very nice picture to think about what's going on in the rock and how the stress is affected. But if we go back to this picture, can we simultaneously take all these other factors into account? Now, as I say, for some subjects, it may not be important to do that, but in the case of radioactive waste disposal, where we're talking about thousands of years, we need really to think about how all these factors affect the rock mass over time. Now, I just noticed I'm running out of time here, so I'm going to have to move forward a bit faster. So I'll move on to excavation and support in fractured rock masses. And because we can't see what's going on underground, I'm showing some pictures of pre-split blasting to demonstrate the effect of the rock mass structure on the fracturing. And here are some very nice rock faces by Highway in France. And the method of pre-splitting, which many of you will know, is that if you have a free face here and you want to go back to a free face here, to a new face here, you have boreholes here containing explosives. And you put in a fairly low amount of explosives, you detonate them all simultaneously, and a fracture goes through there, if you're lucky. And I think if you can see on this picture from some distance, you can see these lines coming down here, which are the half barrels. So once the fracture goes right down there, you're left with these little semicircles here, which are these fractures here. Now, this has been very well done. You can see that the boreholes are parallel for which way the explosive was in. And this face is very nice. And here's another face. And so to avoid the rock mass structure affecting the engineering in this particular case, you can angle the drill holes, the blast holes, so they're perpendicular to the strata. And here, when the rock is not so good, this pre-splitting doesn't work quite so well. And of course, if the rock is not so good, it will weather as well. And if it gets even worse, you can end up with a face like this. Now, maybe depending on how far back that is, maybe that's safe enough. But what I want to illustrate here is the fact that the rock mass structure is affecting the engineering. And here's another example. This is in Sweden. And this is not a problem with the pre-split blasting here, but just to show how the in-situ fractures affect the result. And so you can see these half barrels here, but we have the pre-existing fractures all over the place, and so blocks are quite happy to fall out there. And so depending how big the blocks are, this may or may not be an engineering problem. Now, there's some very nice experiments done at Newcastle University to study the influence of the rock mass structure on this blasting process. And so these were done in Perspex or plexiglass. It's called Perspex in the UK and plexiglass in North America, polymethyl methacrylate. And it's nice because it's transparent. And so the experiment, I was in the block here, and there are some simulated fractures there, and there are detonators put in holes here. So when the detonators are all set off simultaneously, you get a star crack, and you get reflection. So the compressive wave is coming out here, is reflected as a tensile wave, and you get damage around here. Now, even so, with any luck, you may get a fracture going right through there. So even though this is quite severe fracturing, you may still be able, the pre-split blasting may still work. But then if the fractures are angled more severely, as in this case here, where there is a detonator here and here and here in the laboratory test, and you have the angle here, you get the reflections off the free surface here, star crack going out there, and still you may get the pre-split blast going through it here. And of course, if you have a situation like this where there's a detonator here, here, and here, everything reflects off and you get the line there. So actually, this pre-split blasting method is quite robust, even though the rock may be rather fractured. So I thought these experiments were quite nice. Now let's look at what happens when you're in the field and you have a rather fractured rock mass. So the first thing is you have to be able to drill the blast holes, first of all, and they should be parallel to one another. So then you have to make sure that the person who's drilling the holes is a good contractor, or could no contractor drill the holes very nicely there. And so these are some examples where the rock is severely fractured and the attempts at pre-split blasting have been very difficult. And so I want to finish my talk now with a concluding quotation from Lan Ru Jing. Many of you will know Lan Ru Jing. He's from China, but he works at KTH, the Royal Institute of Technology in Stockholm. And he was a colleague of mine, and when I was editor of the International Journal of Rock Mechanics and Mining Sciences, I asked him to write a review paper on techniques, advances, and outstanding issues in numerical modeling for rock mechanics and rock engineering. So he wrote this 70-page paper, and it's a fantastic paper. And I really like this this quotation at the bottom here. Success in numerical modeling for rock mechanics and rock engineering depends almost entirely on the quality of the characterization of the fracture system, geometry, physical behavior of the individual fractures, and the interaction between intersecting fractures. The engineer needs a predictive capability for design And that predictive capability can only be achieved if the rock reality has indeed been captured in the model and the rock fractures dominate. It's almost like poetry, that. And so that's the message of my talk. So I want to thank again the ISRM for this honor that they have bestowed on me. And over the last 50 years, I've worked with many friends and colleagues over the years, and I want to thank them as well. But finally, I want to thank my wife for her companionship and help throughout my career. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Hardison, for your very excellent and exciting MUDA lectures. So this tells us what should we concern with fracture rock masses, and how to concern, and what we have achieved with fracture rock masses. So now I'm going to introduce the Roger Medal. Award of the Manuel Rocha Medal 2015. So Rocha Medal is honors the in memory of Professor Manuel Rocha, the second ISRM president and organizer of the Fourth Congress in 1966. Professor Rocha was the leader responsible for the transforming the ISRM into a real international scientific association. So he settled the fundamental lines that have guided and supported the society's activities along the years. Roger Medal is awarded annually since in 1981 aims at stimulating young rock mechanics researchers. So this award is given for our outstanding doctoral thesis as a result of worldwide core competition. The award consists of a medal and a cash prize. Also, we give up to two runner-up certificates. So Rocha Medal 2015, the runner-up certificate is awarded to Dr. Ahmadi Reza Hadayat from Iran for his PhD thesis, Mechanical and Geophysical Correlation of Damage in Rocks, contacted at Purdue University in the United States. The winner is Dr. Andrew Lisjak from Italy, for his PhD thesis on investigating the influence of mechanical anisotropy on the fracture behavior of fracture clay shells with application to deep geological repository from University of Toronto in Canada. Dr. Andrew received his bachelor degree in civil engineering at the University of Italy in 2006. Also, he received a master's degree at the same university in 2008. He received a PhD degree in civil engineering rock mechanics at the University of Toronto, Canada, 2013. And then he became a geomechanical specialist at the Mechanical Inc., Toronto, Canada, since then. So Dr. Andrew gave Roger Medal lectures on investigating the influence of mechanical anisotropy on the fracturing behavior of brittle clay shells with application to the deep geological repositories. So congratulations. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. Thanks for being here. Thanks, Professor Feng, for the introduction. And also like to thank the members of the award selection committee for this award, which is a great pleasure and honor to receive. So my presentation today, I'll essentially go through basically the research path that I followed during my PhD. So starting with the problem that I was trying to solve, the limitation and the state of the art of previous studies, talking a bit about the modeling, numerical modeling approach I chose, and then I'll talk about theoretical and practical advancement of my research. So look into failure simulation of failure process in brittle rocks, modeling mechanical anisotropy of clay shales, and look into how the damage develops around the ground excavation. In the last part, I'll talk about the application of this approach to in situ experiment from the Monterey Underground Laboratory. So just a bit of a background, clay shales are currently being assessed as a potential host rock formation for the deep geological disposal of radioactive waste. And the reason for this is that because they have very good isolation property, so very low hydraulic conductivity, and also potential for self-sealing of fractures. However, one concern is related to the damage induced around the underground excavation, the so-called EDZ excavation damage zone. So the EDZ has implications both in the short term, when it comes to tunnel constructability, design of the support, excavation sequencing, and so on, but more importantly, in the long term, because the fracturing might be associated with an increase of permeability, and so a negative impact on the isolation property of the rock mass. So essentially, the main motivation behind this research is to try to get it to gain a better understanding of how the EDZ actually form in this type of material. And if we can do that, then we can increase the confidence in performance and safety assessment for underground repository. So the material that I researched is this is the opalinus clay, which is a candidate host rock for a deep geological repository in Switzerland. It's a very unique material. It's somewhat defined as a transitional material between a hard soil or a soft rock. It's definitely brittle, so when it fractured, when it failed, actually fractured. And also is strongly bedded, so the mechanical characteristics are really depending upon the loading orientation. And lots of research is currently going on in Monterey, an underground laboratory in Switzerland. So the EDZ in opalinus clay really depends on the direction of the excavation with respect to bedding. So what's generally observed is that if you excavate perpendicular to the bedding, excavation are typically stable, and the failure that occurs is typically only stress control. Meanwhile, when you excavate parallel to the bedding strike, failure has been observed, and this failure is heavily controlled by the weak bedding planes. As you can see here in this picture, with distinctive failure mechanism, shearing of bedding and buckling. The second case, however, is the most relevant for the actual design of the repository, where the bedding is expected to be horizontal. Just a bit of background on previous modeling studies before my work. Essentially, were mostly continuum-based elastoplastic models. Starting with the work of in the early 2000s of Professor Martin and Dr. Lanyon, and then other models by Corcom and Martin. So as such, those models couldn't really capture the brittle fracture process of the rock. Some more work has been done using discontinuum models, like UDEC and 3DEC and so on. But the focus there was mostly on the effect of pre-existing discontinuities, not on the fracturing process itself. So with my work, the idea was to use a code that can explicitly reproduce the fracturing process, and this is a code based on a hybrid finite discrete element method. So the overall goal was to further develop this method and validate it, and specifically looking at the effect of mechanical anisotropy on fracture nucleation and propagation in shales. To achieve this goal, I would say three main objectives were set. first one, we want to further validate the method in terms of if the method is actually able to capture brittle failure in just in rock, not necessarily anisotropic. And in particular, the focus one was on the acoustic activity of rock. Once that was done, we focused on the actual anisotropy, so implementing some solution to capture both stiffness and strength anisotropy. And finally, calibrate one of this model based on field measurement from another ground laboratory. Just very briefly how this method works. It's essentially a hybrid continuum-discontinuum approach where the finite element analysis takes care of the elastic deformation of the rock. And then this is coupled with discrete element algorithms to capture fracture and fragmentation using a cohesive element method, and also the interaction of discrete bodies, either if you have pre-existing discontinuities or discontinuities that emerge during the fracturing process. Essentially, the rock is discretized with triangles. The triangles themselves cannot break. They're just deformable, and they capture the stiffness of the material. And between each triangle, we have this four-noded cohesive element, which I use to actually capture the brittle fracture. So the characteristic here of the method is the constitutive model that is implemented at the crack element level. So those crack elements can fail in tension or in shear. And there is a post-peak displacement softening behavior, which is governed by the mode 1 and mode 2 fracture energy in tension and in shear, respectively. The code that we used was an open source code, and that's because that will have, in that way, we'll have the flexibility required to add features to the method. So as I said, the first part of the research was mainly focused on further validating the code in terms of can we reproduce brittle failure in rock correctly. And we look into can we capture the release of seismic energy during the fracture propagation process. So this is just a simple example to look into. So this is a simulation of a compression test, no confinement, and there is a pre-existing discontinuity there at the center. So we compress that, and we can simulate the wing cracking, so tensile fracture developing from the flaw. But at the same time, we are also recording the particle velocity on the side of the specimen, as you would do in the laboratory. So you can see we can record synthetic seismograms. So as fracture nucleate and propagate, the elastic energy that is stored in the rock is released, and is released in the form of seismic waves. So we were actually able to use that information to go and locate back the source of the event. So that way, we validate the approach also from a dynamic point of view. We also developed a method to actually quantify the energy released by the fracturing process by monitoring the kinetic energy of nodes around the crack, a nucleating and propagating crack. And that energy was verified to scale with the actual energy that is recorded far away from the source. We applied this algorithm to a unconfined compression test on rock. So the model was previously calibrated. This is a granite model, previously calibrated to match the stress-strain response of an actual laboratory test. But then we look into the actual seismic, the acoustic activity model during the simulation. And we divided the stress-strain curve in several stages. And for each stage, we computed the acoustic emission, which are plotted here with the color proportional to the magnitude. So as you can see here, there is an increase, general increase of magnitude as you approach failure. And also you go from a diffuse distribution of source location towards localized fracture pattern. We actually did some more quantitative analysis looking at the frequency magnitude distribution of this event. And we show that they actually follow the Gutenberg-Richter relationship with generally a decrease in B value as you approach a macroscopic failure. And also looking at the fractal dimension of the source location, same thing, decrease of fractal dimension. So you go from diffuse source location to localization as you approach failure. Then we start looking to how do we model the anisotropy of the shale. So the first solution we came up with was this one. So essentially, the stiffness anisotropy, we simply implemented a transversal isotropic constitutive model for the finite element. While to capture the strength anisotropy, we try with this approach. We essentially insert pre-existing cracks into the model. And essentially, the anisotropy of strength of failure mechanism emerges as a natural property of the model. So you can see, by doing this, you get actual splitting when you load parallel to the bedding and shear through the intact matrix when you load perpendicular to them. And the strength response actually follow quite nicely the expected U-shaped strength variation. The shear mechanism along the bedding plane, however, is not captured as actual a shear failure, but it's captured as a coalescence of those pre-existing cracks via wing cracking. So the issue here is that to reproduce this bedding plane delamination very well, you need very small element because you need to be able to have a very fine spacing between those pre-existing cracks. So there is some issue when you try to upscale this with at the tunnel scale where you cannot use small element. So we need to come up with a better solution. So the idea was to then incorporate the anisotropy directly into the fracture model. So essentially we go and we vary the cohesive strength parameters of the rock as a function of the orientation of this crack element with respect to the bedding. And in this case, we assume a minimum strength property when you're on the bedding plane, maximum strength properties when you're perpendicular to them and with a linear relationship in between. And we were able to calibrate the model to reproduce again the U-shaped strength response of the model. And in this case, however, when you load at an angle with respect to the bedding plane, so when you have the lower strength, you actually simulate real shear failure, which was the objective of this type of model. So then we applied this to a tunnel. So in this case, it would be a circular tunnel, isotropic in situ stress field with horizontal bedding. So we simulate that, and we can look at how fractures start to nucleate. So in this case, you start with shearing along the bedding planes, okay, here in the hunch area, which is where the bedding planes are least favorably oriented with respect to the maximum principal stress. Of course, this is consistent with, you could have just find this location by looking at a simple elastic model where you can compare the stress distribution around the tunnel with the distribution of strength of a hypothetical rock core oriented along the tunnel. So you can see here where the stress is greater than the strength, that's where you can expect failure. However, what you cannot do with the continuum model, you cannot then follow how fracture will keep growing. So in this case, you can see you have slippage along the bedding planes, and this slippage induce some mode one fracturing, so extensional failure spalling in the direction perpendicular to them. And if you leave this unsupported, you start seeing some buckling of layers, which is again in agreement with the observation of this type of rocks. Then we look at what's the effect of the change in the in situ stress field. So if you have an isotropic in situ stress field, so for example, in this case, sigma 1 is greater than sigma 3, sigma 1 is vertical. So what you can see is that because of the stress redistribution around the tunnel, the lateral growth of bedding plane fracture is suppressed, because you have an increase of frictional resistance, and instead the failure tends to propagate in the vertical direction instead. So you end up with a vertically elongated fractured zone. On the other hand, if the maximum principal stress is horizontal, the bedding slippage is greatly enhanced because you have lower frictional resistance here. But also interestingly, this fracture then prevents the flow of sigma 1 in the back and the inverse, so you actually have less fracturing in the vertical direction. So you end up with this characteristic wing-shaped fractured zone. In the last part of the research, I was fortunate enough to be involved in the Monterrey project, and specifically in this full-scale emplacement FE experiment, which is a multi-phase experiment that simulates the construction, waste emplacement, backfilling, and heat generation of an emplacement tunnel according for high-level nuclear waste according to the Swiss concept. So this was done at Monterrey Underground Laboratory, northwestern Switzerland. It's essentially a 50-meter-long tunnel, 3-meter diameters. different support measure in the central section, which is the one we model. We mostly had the shotcrete and some anchors, some steel sets at the end, and here close to the starting niche. This tunnel was excavated parallel to the bedding plane strike, which is the case that we are interested in. The rock mass response during the excavation was monitored using different tools, including a measurement of the convergency of the excavation perimeter, extensometers, both in direction parallel and perpendicular to the bedding, as well as some inclinometers in the crown. So this is a perfect case for a calibration of a numerical model of this type. So here's some of the actual field measurement for what concerns tunnel deformation. Very large displacement were observed, so with convergence up to 2%. So clearly not compatible with a purely elastic rock mass response. And at the same time, a strong tunnel ovalization due to the presence of bedding, as well as the heterogeneous response here, so not polar symmetric, and because of a presence of a fault. So this was the kind of data that was used to calibrate the numerical model. That one, and also inclinometer data. So essentially, inclinometer data were able to capture the vertical displacement profile along the tunnel in advance of the tunnel excavation. So these lines here represent the profile of vertical displacement at this point here, 1 meter above the tunnel roof, for different position of the tunnel face. So as you can see, for a given position of the tunnel excavation face, displacement already recorded ahead of it, so three-dimensional effect. And at the face, the maximum displacement were typically between 30 and 40% of the total displacement recorded at that specific section. So this was the kind of data that was used, given the b-dimensionality of the model, to estimate the pre-convergency and then decide when to activate the support. So the model calibration, in a first attempt, we actually tried to match the absolute displacement at all those 4 points with the model, and that was really not possible because of the heterogeneous response observed in the field due to the presence of a fault. The fault was at this stage not included in the model. So we just look at relative convergences between these points, and we were able to match quite well what was observed in the field here in green observation and in gray the model. Again, with exception of this line here at the bottom because of the fault. And in yellow here, you have the elastic model, which clearly underpredicted the displacement. So the model was calibrated, and this was the displacement field at equilibrium, where you can see elastic behavior in the direction parallel to the bedding, and rock fracturing with rock mass bulking in the direction perpendicular to bedding. The interesting thing, though, with this type of approach is you can actually go back and then look at how the EDZ was actually generated. And here again, similar mechanism to what was shown before. So shearing along critically oriented bedding planes, those bedding planes, as they shear, they induce some tensile fracture, so spalling here perpendicular to them. And then when you then install the support, activate the shotcrete, you can stabilize the fracturing process. But at the end, you still end up with an inner zone highly damaged, and then some outer zone where you have isolated shear fractures. You can look at the in situ stress after at equilibrium, and you can notice that the stress field, the concentration of stresses are depending upon the in situ stress. So in this case, the sigma 1 is vertical, 6.5 MPa, and sigma 3 is horizontal, 4.5. But there's also stress concentration induced by the fracturing process itself. And you can see rock mass deconfinement in this head, so that's consistent with the spalling. And as you increase the confining stress with depth, you suppress the spalling, and you only have shear fractures. So some conclusion from this work, we verify that, show actually, that for tunnels excavating parallel to the bedding strike, failure initiated with shearing on bedding planes, and then that evolves with extensional fracturing, and spalling and buckling is promoted by the bedding plane delamination. So if you can control the deconfinement and the slippage along the bending planes, you can try to control the EDZ development. If in situ stress is anisotropic, you can expect a fracture pattern that's substantially different than what you expect under isotropic condition. In general, the model that was developed for this work was applied to underground nuclear waste disposal, but can be applied to other problems that involve fracturing of layer material, such as borehole stability and hydraulic fracturing. Finally, some recommendation for future work. There's definitely a need to validate more the fracture pattern that was simulated for the FE experiment by going in the field and looking at the comparing with fracture pattern from rock cores. There's definitely a need to look better into the effect of geological heterogeneity and pre-existing fracture, like the one, the fault that was not accounted for in the model. Definitely a need to go to 3D modeling, and something is already being done in the sense, especially to look at the effect of the excavation, what happens ahead of the excavation phase. Another important aspect that was neglected in my work is the presence of fluid, so poor mechanical effects should be incorporated into this kind of model. And also, some work has also been done in this regard, looking at how to integrate this result into a long-term safety assessment for the underground repository. Finally, some acknowledgement. I want to thank, there's many people that have helped and contributed, provide support for this work, and I wish to thank specifically the help from my PhD supervisor, Professor Grasselli, and my colleagues Omid Mahbadi and Brian Tatone, and the support from NSERC, NAGRA, and the partners of the Monterrey project. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much, Andrea, for your nice talk. So this plenary session comes to end. So thank you all of you for attending. Thank you.
The coffee is outside. Please go and help yourself. But please be back here at 10:45 sharp. Thank you.